Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Accepting My Facade presentation, Jesus teaches that the first step to remove facade is to accept it, which includes examining truthfully our primary desires and emotional state, eliminating denial and judgment, developing compassion, and removing unloving desires blocking acceptance. Recorded on the 22nd of May 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
So, did you feel a bit relieved after your stay?
Yeah.
No. That sounded like a gen comment. David, you'd like to?
Yeah, could I share two brief comments from my pickup?
Yeah, depending whether I have to correct them or not. Fire away.
I was journaling this morning about facade and what we learnt yesterday.
Yeah.
And I started to have the feeling for little David, it was kind of a bit like a war in a sense. And then I thought, no, it's kind of more like genocide over an extended period, you know, yeah. And a bit systematic. And somehow somehow God was even tied up in it all.
Yeah.
That was kind of the feeling or belief I imbibed.
Yeah, obviously what we currently have on earth is the opposite of what God would like to see on the earth. But God also honours the fact that we make choices. We're allowed to make choices that cause our own degradation. And so, and God knew that when God gave us the gift of free will, that the possibility was that we would make choices that would cause our own degradation. But interestingly, and one of the things we'll learn with all of God's laws is that all of the laws are that revolve around the soul, which are the highest laws of the universe. They all are about the redemption of the soul as well. So God, not only did God foreknew that we would probably engage a process of self-degradation as humanity, but God also created a whole heap of laws to recover from that place. So that shows you how much God planned for the fact that we might use our will out of harmony with love.
And I also thought it's kind of like, yeah, we're eschewing all those things and we're kind of wandering around as adults like we've got post-traumatic stress disorder.
We are. We have, yeah. And that's pretty close to accurate, actually, from our childhood. It's very, you know, there are some people who experience a better childhood than most, but it's pretty rare. Yeah.
And the other thing I felt was... that little David, and it probably applies to most, if not all.
Yeah.
One of my big issues, and others have theirs, is giving my will away. And I kind of started to have the feeling that I had to.
Yes.
In order to survive.
Yes. Yeah, that's how you were taught to do so by your family. Yeah. And this is why most of you had your will sort of taken from you, I suppose you could say. And this is why you're finding it very hard to actually exercise your will in a loving way now, because you don't have a very firm resolve inside of yourself. Because in the past, particularly in your childhood, whenever you've had a firm resolve, it's always been knocked to hell and back, you know. Mm. It's a sad thing that we do to our children. We basically, instead of encouraging the development of their will in a loving manner, we basically knock their will around so that their will becomes our will. Yeah. It's very sad. Kate, you'd like to say? We need to get onto the subject in a minute.
Oh, I was just going on from what you were saying about that God's laws are structured. I was thinking about that myself, and because I'm pretty worried about this global terror. Yeah, this
you,
business.
You and everyone else are.
Yeah. But then it was sort of like we can take faith in the fact that, like, the most loving and powerful creator in the world, even just intellectually remind ourselves of this, that this structure is in place. We just need to yeah, there's a lot of power in that,
yeah,
that can help us not get as freaked out.
Or. Yeah, this is where faith in God's goodness, you're definitely going to need to develop some faith in God's goodness to pass through that barrier. You definitely are. And faith is a very key part of your development, in fact, for the rest of your existence, not just while you've got error either, not just while you've got pain. After even all the pain is gone, faith is a very important quality to develop. Yeah. So good opportunity to develop now. But we need to move on because this particular talk, it could take 10 hours. So I don't know how I'm going to talk about everything I want to talk about in this talk, but it is a key thing that I'd like to talk to you about. So this talk is Accepting My Facade. It sounds pretty simple, but we need to understand our facade really well in order to accept it. And so this is what we'd like to talk about today. Before I start, though, on the discussion, I want to say something that we will talk more about when I give you some group feedback, and that is accepting the facade is the hardest thing you'll probably have to do, right? And in fact, the majority of people who've heard divine truth on the planet while they're on Earth, and in that I would classify hundreds of thousands in the first century and hundreds of thousands in this life who have heard divine truth while they've been on Earth, almost every single one of them, once they start confronting their facade, leaves the truth. Right? Almost every single one of them. And for many of you, you've not started confronting your facade yet, so you haven't actually gone through that particular process. And there is such a strong desire to avoid the facade that many of my friends in the first century are still in the hells today because they from the first century because they avoided their facade and still are avoiding their facade, still are in that cycle. This cycle of anger and rage and addiction is still going on for them. For many of the other friends, the so-called apostles and disciples that you know of, many of them avoided their facade while on earth as well. And it wasn't until the spirit world that many of them started to confront it. It's a pretty rare person who does it on earth. But there are huge advantages to accepting your facade while on earth, because it now gives you the power to change it. And once you've got the power to change it, you've also got the power to have a quiet and a very enjoyable and happy life on earth. But it requires getting through some barriers, and that's what I'd like to talk to you about today. So let's look at accepting our facade. Before we can accept our facade, we really need to understand the state of the facade, because that's the thing we need to accept, that we're in a certain state. You know, we have a certain layers of attitudes and layers of beliefs and layers of emotion that put us in a state, which is a facade-based state. So we need to be able to identify the facade-based state. So the facade has two primary desires. And if you can see the facade in the map here, right, then you would see that basically there must be two primary desires of the facade. The first primary desire of the facade is related to pain, right? So the first primary desire of the facade, so if we just write them down, like primary desires of the facade, the first one is to avoid pain at all costs, right? Now, it's not only just avoid pain, and probably I'd prefer to use the word to desensitize self to pain. And not only to my pain, but also to the pain of others, because the pain of others usually also triggers my pain in some way. Does that make sense? So the role of the facade is to attempt to desensitize myself emotionally to it all. Now, this even involves the role of the facade getting angry about pain rather than actually surrendering to the pain. Does that make sense? And that's a part of the desensitization process. Getting angry about the pain desensitizes you to the sadness related to the pain. So the role of the facade is to firstly desensitize myself to pain, of my own pain and others' pain. That's its first role. It's an intense demand that is driven by the terror, which brings us to the second role of the facade: to avoid feeling terror. Terror and fear at all costs, any cost. Murder is still acceptable by almost everybody in the Western world, as well as all the other parts of the world, as a way of avoiding terror. And as I pointed out yesterday, for many women, even like aborting a child is a action of terror, usually driven by a fear of some kind, and there's a murder committed just to avoid fear or terror. So we're willing to do it, and we encourage other people to do it. And there are now socially acceptable forms of murder, which abortion is one. Right? War is another. Going to war is another socially acceptable form of murder. And we engage it because of terror, our avoidance of terror. So they are the primary desires of the facade. Does everyone get those two desires? Yeah, pretty simple, isn't it? Your facade's driven by those two things. So it's very, very simple to see its motivations. Right. So now what we'd like to see, what we'd like to do, is to identify from that what state the facade is actually in, because while it's trying to do this. Does that make sense? What does the facade try to do, or it wants to do, while it's trying to do this? Trying to do these two, you know, satisfy these two primary compulsions, these two primary desires. So, Joanne, thanks.
It wants to pander to fear.
Yes, it does.
Wants to do everything fear tells it to do.
Yeah, well, let's list a few things that it does, shall we, sort of in some kind of order. These are all not in priority order. These are just things that it does. So let's look at the first one that we have a tendency to do, and that is to lie. We lie to ourselves. We lie to others about ourselves. We present a lie. When, you know, quite frequently you're feeling inside one thing, but you say another thing to another, to a person. Frequently that happens. You know, someone comes up, asks you how you are, you do it. Somebody comes up and asks you, are you doing this or are you doing that? And you assess whether you might get attacked or you might get abused or you might get whatever, saying what you really want to say, and so you don't say it, right? It's presenting a lie to others. The facade justifies lies constantly. And this is why the truth is so confronting to the facade. Right? The facade is you could think of it as it's error, but error fights for itself. So the facade is there fighting for itself. And like I said, it's willing to kill for itself. That's how extreme it is. And you're willing to harm other people every single moment of a day, even for the protection of this facade, because the terror and the pain, the belief, the false belief that you can't cope with both of those things, just causes you to feel that lying is justified. Yeah. The next thing it does is it justifies itself to you. And, you know, it's like everybody's got one. You can't sort of live without one. You're going to get attacked if you don't do it. You know, you're going to get harmed by other people if you don't do it. The facade is good for you. It's the best. is putting my best foot forward. You know, you almost believe that it's like, it's the best part of you, right? Now society does believe it's the best part of you. And your parents, who had a large part in constructing your facade or helping you construct your facade, also believe it's the best part of you. So certainly when you start taking away your facade, you are going to have some form of opposition from your parents. If they're still alive on earth or in the spirit world, doesn't really matter. They're going to oppose you doing it. Unless they themselves have done it, they will oppose you doing it. And society certainly on earth is going to oppose you doing it. It's automatic. And this is why we go, well, you can't survive without your facade. It's not possible. All right. In the first century, I survived 34 years without my facade. Right. It's not very long, really, is it? And I was tortured quite a number of times, three times in that period as well. Yeah. Doesn't bode well, does it? Besides being tortured to death, you know. So that makes you feel really motivated, doesn't it? It's like. But can you see that assessment then causes you to justify the facade? You say, well, it's life-threatening. If you don't have a facade, the facade itself is saying, without me, your life is nothing. You're going to die, a pretty quick death probably. So you know, the facade is a justifiable development in oneself. Now, these belief systems did come from your childhood, as in the preamble in the discussion between myself and David just before, when David mentioned that, you know, it was like he was in a battle in his childhood, you know, where he could have been murdered or something. And it's very true, actually. If a child learns very, very quickly that if it continues to act as it wishes to, then it's going to get quite severely abused. Definitely abused in an emotional way, but for the majority of us, and in history, abused in every possible way. Right. So of course we justify the facade. So we justify it. We basically say, well, you know, without it, we're dead. And if you look at history, the people who attempted to live without facade generally didn't survive very long. So that would tend to suggest that your justification is valid, would it not? And this reinforces the desire of the facade to maintain itself. Okay. What does it do with truth? Well, if it's lying all the time, then obviously it's rejecting truth, is it not, all the time? It has no interest in truth. But not only does it have no interest in truth, it actively opposes it. It actively opposes the truth. So whenever the truth is presented to it, it will always attempt to reject the truth. Now, it does that through a number of different means. It enters denial techniques to do it. In other words, it's just like dismissive. Like, I don't have to consider that because it doesn't apply to me. Many of you have done that with me for years, right? Doesn't apply to me, I'll dismiss that, right? Or we go into anger and rage, because we've learned in a childhood that anger and rage, our parents tried it on us, so that's how we learned it, that anger and rage is a way of manipulation of other people and stopping them from saying anything. So if you can get angry and get in a rage with them, then that will prevent them from being able to express to you the truth about what's going on, right? So that's a way of doing it. And another one is to satisfy addictions, right? In other words, to basically you tell yourself that every time somebody is nice to you, and your definition of nice is you meet one of my addictions, right? That makes you nice, then they're the kind of people that you'll spend a bit of time with. And anybody who doesn't meet your addictions at all, then they're the kind of people that you just stay away from. So you end up managing, controlling and managing your external environment. Now, in the Western world now, we have a lot of power to do that. We do. You know, in the first century, if you wanted to travel somewhere, for most people it meant walking there, right? Here, we can go to the other side of the world in a day, right? If we want to get some kind of addiction met. I know a guy who traveled to Amsterdam because he wanted to take drugs freely without getting in trouble. So he did, he flew there. You can do that on Earth. In the first century, you would have been struggling doing that. Mind you, there wasn't too many. Well, no, there was plenty of drugs. There wasn't too many laws against them, actually. There was hardly any laws at all against drugs in the first century. So taking drugs was a pretty normal occurrence. But here in the 20th century, if you want to, you just go to a country that lets you do it. Yeah. There's plenty of people who travel specifically for sex. You know, they travel somewhere because it's easier to have sex with underage people, or it's easier to have sex, you know, of different types with different people in certain countries, because it's highly unlikely that they'll ever be found out or caught or doing things that are unloving to other people. So they do that. If we need to make some alcohol in the 20th century, making alcohol, you know, we've all stopped doing that because we can just buy it down in every corner store. In fact, almost in Australia, any tiny little country town has a pub. You know, like near where we live, 20 k's away, 15 k's away, is Tingura, a little tiny town. Drive through there, there's no stores, there's no convenience stores, there's no anything else, but there is a pub. And it's a drive-through bottle shop. When I told some people overseas about that, they said, "What? A drive-through bottle shop?" Yeah, you drive through and you sit in your car and you order what you want and they give it to you. In America, you do that with money, but here we do it with here we do it with alcohol. So what is that? Everything is easy, isn't it? We can easily avoid reality here. Right. Now, one thing I'd like to say about that too is the state of the facade is actually living in a state of what I would classify as unreality. In other words, you're not real about God's laws. You're not real about yourself. You present an unreal version of yourself to the world. They interact with the unreal version of you. So you're actually living in a an imaginary state, really. And we call that, on Earth, we call that reality, but God calls that crazy. On Earth, it's called normal. Right? But it's totally crazy. Because we're living in a state where almost every interaction we have with any person is based upon a whole heap of facade that we feel we must maintain. And that even gets right down to the facade with husband and wife. Like most relationships I see are living in a facade, not presenting their true selves to each other even. Like, and if you can't do it with the closest person in your life, how are you going to be able to do it with everyone else? You're definitely not going to do it with everyone else, are you? So it's a big issue with the facade. This is part of its state. So here what we're doing is now focusing ourselves, these are the primary desires, and here we're focusing on the state of the facade. So we're still talking about its state. And when I talk about the word the state of the facade, it's the current condition. The current condition of our soul is in this state. Right? Now, if you examine the notes that I've given you for this section, you can see that in this area we've listed quite a few main points, if you like, about the state of the facade. And what I would like to do is just basically read them out to you, because we're not going to have time to discuss them in a lot of detail. But I'd like to read them out to you, and then perhaps we can put it open for you to ask questions about each state. Does that sound all right with you? And we have only about 10 or 15 minutes that we can spend on this, so we want to understand as much of this as we can, as possible. So the first state we've already looked at: I tell myself lies about my facade. So I tell myself that I deny I don't even have one, or I tell myself that I don't live in it all the time, and I tell myself that it's not a bad thing, you know, it's a good thing, and doesn't hurt me, and it's good for me, and it's good for other people, all those kind of things. They are the things I tell myself. I tell myself my facade is serving me well. Right? Now, as we learnt yesterday afternoon, that was probably true in your childhood, right? Because without your facade, you possibly, and I would say most probably, would have struggled to survive. And certainly you would have ended up with even more problems than you currently have if you had not engaged your facade, right? So that is true in your childhood, but the trouble is we're now adults and we still tell ourselves the same thing. We've now left home. We've now, you know, left the environment, the primary environment, the parental home, of our upbringing. We've left that primary environment as adults, but we're still engaging exactly the same facade as we were before. Does that make sense? I tell myself lies about my pain. So remember, everything is about avoiding pain. Everything is about desensitizing ourselves to pain. So what we start doing is we tell ourselves lies about the pain itself, that it's not even there, that we don't have it. I can't remember. Like, how frequently do we say, I can't remember my childhood? I can't remember what happened. Well, I can tell you why you can't remember, because most of the things that probably happened weren't very nice. Right? So, of course, you don't want to remember. Why is it that Alzheimer's and memory loss type of injuries in old age, you know, these so-called diseases, which are really all emotional diseases, why are they happening in more prevalence today? It's because most people don't want to remember. And so they try to shut down the memory, the emotional memory of the pain happened in their past, right? And it's a big issue. Avoidance of the pain. I tell myself that I don't have pain. That if I do have pain, that it's not related to anything to do with my childhood. It's just some kind of physical thing that happened, and I don't really understand. And maybe God's a mongrel, and that's the reason why it happened. You know, and my primary motivation is to avoid it at all costs. So I take pills to avoid it. I take action to avoid it. I eat to avoid it. I do everything I can to avoid it. Right? So this telling myself lies about the pain itself. I also deny that I am terrified. So I deny this. I deny that I am terrified, that I have a problem, with emotion, that I'm terrified of emotion. I really don't want to experience any kind of emotion unless I can be guaranteed that that emotion is pleasurable in some way. That's it. And so what I try to do then is I start to select emotion. I try to select emotion. So many of you have been in this cycle of selecting emotion, right? Denying the painful one and trying to accept the pleasurable one, but the problem is your pleasure decreases as that occurs, because the more and more pain you're in, the more difficult it is to deny one type of emotion while you're trying to accept another. Right? So, and the soul's not built that way, in fact. So you're using your intellect and your willpower to deny emotion, and the soul itself is naturally desiring to feel emotion. And so you're working against the operation of the way God's designed your own soul to do that. And that's why it becomes harder and harder and harder. And this is why when we're very old, we're usually so desensitized to any pleasurable emotion that most people are just grouches. Aren't they? Like, it's very rare to meet a happy adult, a happy old a person in old age, unless they have most of their addictions getting met. And you take away one of their addictions and then have a good interaction with them then? No, like how many times have I seen that at a supermarket, you know, where an old lady, she's badgering the counter person and some of them swearing at them and cursing them. And, you know, if they had a knife, they'd pull it out and probably try to go for it. You know, they're so angry by this stage because they have very little pleasure in their life because they've denied the pain. And in denying the pain, you can't also experience pleasure. So it's a big problem. My definitions of love are corrupt. Everything I think about love, from God's perspective, is probably completely the opposite of what I think. It's pretty confusing, isn't it? Like, so what you believe, when you believe you're being loving, most of the time, from God's law's perspective, you're not. And when you believe you're not being loving, that somebody's not being loving to you, most of the time, a lot of the times, from God's perspective, they are. Right? Very confusing. But that's the state of our facade. My beliefs of what are true, what is true and real are corrupt. So I believe that certain things are true and they're not. And I believe that certain things are false, but they're not. They're true. So everything's mixed up. Right? My definitions of sin are corrupt. I either don't believe there's such a thing as sin, or I believe that it's a construction of some Christian person, you know, like the Jesus character in the Bible, or I believe that other people sin and I don't. I'm more perfect than everyone else around me is. I understand things better than everybody else does. I tell myself lies about my real emotions. So, you know, I say, oh, I'm doing this really good thing for this other person. I'm such a nice person doing this good thing for that other person. And really the motivation is so that they will tell you that you're a nice person. So are you a nice person? No, you just want something in return, but and you're only doing it to barter emotion. But you're telling yourself that, no, you've got good motivation. Right. And the last one I've listed there, and there's many more we could list, I want to use my will to sin. I want to sin because, you know, when I say I want to sin, it's not how we think about it. We just say, I want to meet my addictions. And we say that our addictions aren't sin, right? We want to meet our addictions. We want to make sure that we get what we want. And so we want to use our will to get our addictions met. And we don't desire to do anything else. We don't desire to fix that because we don't see addictions as a sin. We see them as a good thing. And the whole world sees them as a good thing. You know, you go down the street and you ask the average guy in Australia whether it's good to go to the pub occasionally or not. He'd ask you why you've been, so stupid, right? Of course it's good to go to the pub. And you ask the average guy in Australia, and I feel in most countries of the world, you know, whether it's good to have sex with as many women as they possibly can. Of course it's good. Crazy, just, you know, God didn't, nature didn't make us monogamous, is the statement, isn't it? Particularly men, you know, we've got to go out there and sow your seed. Right. So we see it as normal. We don't see it as sin. We just see it as normal. Now, I could bring up many examples for the ladies as well there. What's the motivation for having a child? For most women, it's to prove that they are a good woman, to prove that they're actually a woman, because a lot of times they're treated by other women like they're not women if they don't have a child. Having a child doesn't make you a woman. Not everyone doesn't make you a woman. But what do? And being a mother, how important that is that to you? Oh, so I've heard so much crap about mothers. Trying to find a song that actually speaks the truth about mothers. Man, you try that. And I've searched for days on the internet, still can't find one. You know, it's like. Because no, everyone wants to lie about it. Right? Now, I'm not saying that we don't have the potential to be loving mothers or loving fathers or loving men or loving women. We do. Of course we do. What I'm saying is the majority of us aren't, because we're in this facade. This is our state. It's our state of living. And we justify. Yeah. Would you like to ask any questions about that before we move on? Thanks. Thanks, Diane.
I was just wondering, are we engaged in our facade in our sleep state?
It's a little harder, but yes, we are usually engaged in our facade in the sleep state as well. There's some very good examples if you want to read about some of them. In the Robert James Lee's books, remember Afra meets his father while his father is in the sleep state. And you will see that his father is still engaging his facade while in the sleep state. So, yep, we certainly do engage our facade while in the sleep state. It's harder to do so with spirits who are developed, because they know when you're just being fake. So the friend who was with Afra could see exactly the motivations of Afra's father. In the book, his name was Frederick, so Frederick's father. I'm saying Afra's name was Frederick, I should say there. But so Frederick's father, a person who's of development in the spirit world, can see the development of his father and say, yeah, we can't do some of the things you want to do here because it's just going to make things worse here because of his facade. It's going to make things worse. But Afra himself, Frederick himself, could not see his father's issues. In fact, he had the emotion of hope that maybe this meant that there was going to be a patch-up of the relationship, when in fact quite the opposite was true. Yeah. But yes, we definitely do engage our facade in the sleep state.
Thank you. The other thing is, there is a song about mothers, yep, right now, and it's Jennifer Lopez.
Right.
And it's called I Ain't Your Mama.
I what?
I Ain't Your Mama.
I Ain't Your Mama.
Ain't.
Ain't Your Mama. Okay. Sorry. Fair enough. Haven't heard it, but yeah. If we come down to Louise down here, and on this side, if we go across to Joanne. And then to Marion.
AJ, I'm just a bit still stuck on the facade. I can understand the hurt self and the real self, even though I'm not accessing my real self. But, like, is the facade an entity, like a construct of myself, like an entity that has a will and thoughts and feelings? Sort of.
No. One thing we must probably say at this juncture is that your facade is a part of your soul at this point in time. So it's a part of what you have made yourself into. It's not a natural part of the development of your personality and nature, but you've made yourself into it in order to conform with parents and society and with your own ideas of what the ideal is. You follow? But it is a soul-based. This whole process does exist in your soul. It's going to require some emotional work to deconstruct it. So sometimes when we talk about the three selves, many of you have the concept of three different parts of yourself. They all make up the sum total of yourself. Does that make sense? So this facade part of yourself is the part of yourself that you tell the world, that you display to the world. And also, unfortunately, many of you have got to the stage where you also display it to yourself. So in other words, you're even lying to yourself about it existing, that you've created it and it exists. And the problem with lying about it to yourself is even worse than lying about it to the world, because while you lie about it to yourself, you have no opportunity to change it. So the pain self, the hurt self, and the facade self, this part of you that you've manufactured to please the world and to please yourself, these parts of you will disappear. but they are actually a part of your soul's emotions at this stage. So the emotional parts of these things exist within your soul at this point.
So Ajay, thank you. So is it like, am I flipping in and out of facade? Like, I'm sometimes my hurt self.
For the majority of people, they live almost permanently in their facade, but they usually have four or five primary facades. And each primary facade is delivered to the audience, that the target audience, if you like. So for example, when you're with your mother, let's say if she's still on earth, you're with your mother, you'll present the facade mummy wants to have. When you're with your daddy, you present the facade that daddy wants, right? Which might be very different to the facade that mummy wanted, right? And then when you're with your colleagues in your work environment, you know, you present a different facade. When you're with, and in the case of you, if you're like in psychology, you might be helping other people, then you'll present a different facade to them. Like, you know, things that maybe you don't know yet and things like that. So because there's authority issues that need to be sort of presented, this is the way we're thinking. And so for most of us, we have five or six primary facades. Usually we have one with our children, one with our partner, one with our father, one with our mother. So there's at least four there. One with society generally, one with work situation and colleagues, right? So they are our primary ones, and then one when we're with friends. So for the majority of us, we have seven at least.
Thank you. So when I'm sharing feelings, like what I, you know, from my hurt self,
yep.
Is that me being in facade when I'm trying to really communicate with someone, but I'm really coming from my hurt self?
Yeah, because a person who's truly feeling their hurt self does not have a strong desire at all to share their feelings with another person. So it's actually driven by an addiction. So therefore a part of the facade. Yeah. When you're truly connecting to your pain, you will probably want to be alone.
Thank you.
We were over here to Joanne, yes?
Your answer to Louise answered pretty well all of my questions.
Good.
But it's a little different.
Yeah.
Do we actually change our facade completely as we get older?
We can do, yes, because we realise that it is a part of ourselves that we can modify, right, depending on the environment. So, of course, as we get older, our environment changes. So you know, when you change from one job to another, you might find that the new job environment is actually different. And so what you try to do now is conform to that particular job environment, modify the facade a bit for that. And when you leave work altogether and retire, now there's a whole heap of other, you know, associations you might have not related to work, and that might be very different to what you had at work, so you modify it again and so forth. And so we actually see our facade as just something we can modify at will, which we do modify it at will. Yeah. And we don't see any problem with that, because we feel that that's a necessary part of interacting with this particular group of people. So if many of us went from here to, say, like Mary did, went from here to Lebanon to live, right, then most of you would modify your facade to suit that particular environment. And for many of you women, that would mean that you'd have to cover over more, that you'd have to be very, very careful how you addressed men, right? You'd have to be very careful how you engaged your job now, you know, in comparison to what these men wanted from you and so forth. You would have to do those particular things in order to conform. That's what you would think. And so you conform. It's an automatic process. So, yes, you do continue to make facade. For the majority of people, they continue to make facade their entire life. Yep. So you may think by the time you've passed into the spirit world, you've got seven primary ones going on, plus whatever other ones were necessary. Yeah. You can see it gets pretty complicated. Can you wonder why we sit down sometimes and worry about decisions for weeks? Because this facade says go for it, that facade says no, don't go for it, because this is the problem and so forth. And it just gets all very, very confusing very rapidly.
Thank you.
Yeah. Go to Marianne, thanks.
Thank you. Matilda has her facades at 18 months old, and I'm wondering whether they're her facades or the person that she's with. Is she reflecting the facade of the person that she's with? And as I undo my facade, which I'm really, really, really hoping to do, will this assist her in changing her facade?
Yes, a good question about children. Children reflect the desires and, well, if we could put it, the violent, because they are violent, desires of the adults surrounding the child. So in other words, the child automatically emotionally assesses the situation in its environment and conforms or displays either one of two patterns in that environment. One is a pattern of opposition to that environment, and the other is a pattern of acceptance of the environment. One of the two will be displayed. Does that make sense? So unfortunately for a child that age, frequently they're not engaging their own will at all, but rather just responding to the wills of its combined environment. Yep, they're reflecting back to that environment, the problem with the environment's will. Yep. And yes, it's an issue that needs to be addressed, obviously, because the majority of children, by the time they get to 5 or 6 years of age, they're in that pattern so much that they now are super sensitive to every environment they're in, and they're automatically conforming to these environments without having any development of their own will yet. And this is why by, you know, the time we're 7 or 8 years of age, generally we've got no idea what we want, no idea what our character is, no idea what our personality is, because a lot of times we've spent the majority of our life already up to that stage conforming to our environment. There's a difference between conforming to an environment and conforming to love. A parent who truly loves their child would actually help the child express its will in harmony with love, and not in harmony with the parent's definition of love, but rather in harmony with God's definition of love. So in other words, the parent is not trying to help the child evolve, right? But rather is trying to help the child love. And that's the role of a parent. You're a bigger sister, or in your case, or a father is a bigger brother, who hopefully has learnt a little bit about love and the use of the loving will, and that's what you would do. You would teach your child how to, what parts of their will are unloving, what parts of the will are loving, and you would always be examining the child's action and asking yourself, well, what part have I played? What are my emotional demands in this situation? What is this triggering inside of me? And this is why when a child enters from 18 months through to usually 3 or 4 years of age, you know, they call it the terrible twos period, where the child now is confronting most of its environment and responding to either in a accepting way or in a rebellious way to its environment's constrictions. And that's very, very confronting for parents. And that's why parents usually during that period resort to corporal punishment or other methods of bribery in order to change the child's behaviour.
We do our best to hold her, and yesterday I was thinking it's her addictions, being on the breast first thing in the morning, and we will hold her. And I came here and I'm like, it's my addictions to needing quietness in the morning, and so I've created her response. So every time we hold her, it's like, come on, where are our emotions? God, can you help us?
Well, a lot of times, there's so many projections at a child. And particularly for a mother, it's very difficult to not engage these projections, because you've already got so many needy holes inside of yourself by the time you're an adult, that having a child validates yourself as a woman, firstly. And breastfeeding the child means you're being a good woman as well, you know, on top of that. And you want to be a good woman for as long as possible. So, of course, the better the woman you are, the longer you'll probably breastfeed. Even if the child no longer needs milk and is eating all sorts of other food, but still comes there. And also, you know, there's emotional bonds now that most women love with their children that are actually quite addictive in their nature, that most most women are trying to engage by continuing, you know, hugging and closeness with the child. Rather than it being an expression of love, it's what they feel when the child does it to them. And these are all addictions in play. And, of course, they need to all be addressed. Yeah. You can see as a child, even under today's guidelines of what a loving mother would do, you're going to end up with quite a strong facade because of all the addictions that are being imposed upon the child and the child feeding back and needing. And in the end, the child feels like it needs mummy to do those things for it because we've created that hole in them too. Yeah.
Pretty horrible.
Yeah, it's pretty horrible. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. You can see why in this, when children pass, they go usually to Summerland, but if they have quite a number of problems, they will be kept in isolation for some time away from other children until some of these problems are addressed. And then what happens is that we have teachers there in that location in the spirit world who teach them what love really is. And they compare the feeling of love for the child, and they often take them back to their parents on earth to compare what they're feeling from the parent, which is often, you know, not love at all, but all the, well, no, it's not just hate, it's all this needy addiction in most cases. And then the child starts recognizing that as a terrible pull upon itself, and then starts distancing itself from the parent until such a time as the parent addresses those particular addictions. But yeah, it's a terrible thing what we do to our children. Terrible thing.
I could feel the vortex images. She just gets sucked into me. Like as soon as I got home last night,
yep.
We were together because yep. She's more me than I am because I feel
correct.
Pretty crap about myself underneath the facade.
Yeah.
And it's just amazing the reflection.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And most parents are pretty confronted by the reflection.
Yeah.
And then they want to blame the character of the child for that. And then they, because the confrontation continues to occur, then they try to mould the character of the child to be what the parent feels more comfortable with.
Mm.
So it's a natural process when you're avoiding pain and avoiding terror. It's a natural process that you're going to engage with any child you have. And the key is to see it and then start to work through the issues surrounding it.
Yeah, I don't want to suck her into my vortex. I want to sort my own vortex.
Yeah, exactly. It's a very important thing to do, Maren.
She's got a lot of holes in her vortex already.
Yeah.
I mean, in her, a lot of holes in her soul already.
Already, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah. Huge. And the more she reflects yours, the more she'll become like you in reality. And the key is to, once you've learnt to address your pain, which is the primary driving force. Remember, there's two driving forces of your facade. One is the desensitization to your pain and the other is the desensitization to terror. If you address the emotion of terror and address feeling the emotions of pain, then, of course, there are all of those holes that are like big sucking vortexes in the soul. They stop rotating in the manner that they do and they stop drawing energy from other people. And that certainly does help the child start to recognize its own will and its own personality and its own desires and its own passions and so forth. And if the parent, in addition to that, teaches the child about love, then of course
God's love.
God's love, yes. Yeah. So anytime I refer to anything else, I'm going to call it evil, right? So, God's love. And when the parent teaches the child about love, then the child now has a way to make a decision about the loving expression of its will. Mm. All right, we better move on because there's quite a lot, as I've pointed out here, there's quite a lot of material I need to cover here. So this is the state of our facade, right? So we've covered the material about the state of our facade as best as I can, given my time. Let's move on to the next main point that we need to talk about. You can see that in your outline. Does anyone want to yell it out for me? Yeah, so the attitude is needed. To accept my facade. Okay. So I think it's getting fairly obvious now, isn't it, the attitude you're going to need? Don't you think? What do you think it is, the attitudes that you're going to need to accept your facade? So non-judgmental. So firstly, we need to remove judgment. I might just use the same colour. Remove judgment. That sounds a lot easier than it is. Honestly, it took me probably 4 years to do that. Before, in that period of time, I used to beat myself, hurt myself, all sorts of things. And then I realized, no, that's not loving either. I can't be doing that. And it took me quite some time to even remove the feeling from me that I wanted to do that. That I wanted to hurt myself for having what I recognized was bad. Does that make sense? Yeah. It's an emotional process you're going to need to go through to remove the judgment. An emotional process. Yeah. Anything else you'd like to mention there, Sam, if we come across? And then on this side, Jen?
Remove the desire to blame and to punish.
Yeah, so let's look at all of those kind of emotions. We've got self-blame, haven't we? And then we've got the blame of others. And then, of course, we've got self-punishment. Self-punishment. And then, of course, we've got the punishment of others. And you could say, you know, we have other terminology we use for that, self-attack, attack of others and so forth. So, yeah, and again, that's quite a difficult thing to do too, because you've been taught to do that from a very, very young age. What we learned in our childhood was that if somebody disapproves of us in some way, then what it meant was that if we continued our behaviour that they disapproved of, eventually they would react and probably violently harm us, or verbally at least harm us in some way. So what we learnt to do was we learnt to adjust their behaviour by us doing what they would do to us. That makes sense? Yeah. So this is how self-blame and self-punishment develops. But it's a pretty hard addiction to give up, because we actually see it as a way of getting the approval of others. Yeah? And for many of you, you believe God's like this too, that God demands self-punishment. And so when you start developing spiritually, you start thinking that God needs you to punish yourself and attack yourself whenever you recognize something you did wrong. It's very hard. Very hard emotion to give up, again, but it's an emotion you need to be able to feel without acting upon in order to release it. Yeah, but that's a very important part of the attitude we need. Anything else? Anything else, Jen? We were at Jen, so.
That it's a construct, that it's what I developed to survive as a child.
Yep.
And that I had a light bulb moment yesterday. Yep. That I do have the power, that there's another part of me even though I haven't discovered it yet, so that it's a construct.
And yeah, let's put it more, I want to write it like this. It's my creation, right? And therefore, I can destroy it. Does that make sense?
I wanted to ask you about that, if I could.
Yep.
When you create something, can it be uncreated?
Yeah, of course. It's like building a house. It's the same with the soul. So in a building a house, you can knock it down.
Okay.
So it's exactly the same with your soul. You build up a whole heap of... You can think of your facade as a mansion of your own making. I don't know if it's a mansion, though. If you actually saw it from a spiritual perspective, it'd probably be more like a hovel, but it's a hovel of your own making that you can bulldoze at any time.
I just reflect upon when I've acted out of facade and hurt another person.
Jen, you're now not asking questions.
Sorry.
You're now stories. Yep. Do I have to do this one? who are we up to next? If we go back to Di at the back and then down to Glenda on this side and then across to here to Pam. Yep, so Pam Blair on this side. So Di?
A willingness to know and embrace God's truth about myself.
Yeah, so my attitude to truth has to change, doesn't it? Can we say it like that? Yeah. My attitude to truth must change. So I must have God's attitude to truth. So what would you say is God's attitude to truth? Well, firstly, God loves it, right? So we need to learn to love truth. It's something that we just can't do without. We can't live without it. So we need to have an attitude of truth where no matter what, we don't compromise it. So God never compromises truth for any person, no matter how bad the situation is. Have you noticed that? You can have a war going on and God won't compromise the truth to help anything. All right? So you can be faced with somebody trying to murder you and God won't compromise the truth in that situation. He will allow your murder. He won't shoot back or strike the person with a bolt of lightning. He could do those things, right? He's powerful enough to instantly destroy any one of us if he so desired. But to do that would require the breaking of his own laws, which he can't do. So God never compromises the truth, ever, under any circumstance, for any reason, doesn't matter whether millions and millions of people are dying or not, it's never going to be compromised. And that's the attitude we need to have. Interesting, isn't it? Yep, you can see that developing that attitude is going to take a bit of time, right? Yeah. Okay, so who are we next? We were down at Pamela. Let's go to Pamela, and then we're down at Glenda on this side.
Compassion. I felt that very strongly yesterday, that compassion helps us with all the other stuff.
Correct. Compassion and understanding. Good. That's really good, yeah. Compassion and understanding. It's such an essential thing. You see, the beauty of having our discussions yesterday, right, about, you know, the creation of the facade was that many of you started to have a little bit more compassion for it. The fact that it was out of your control, in fact, that for many of you, you needed to create it in order to survive. So you had a lot more compassion for it. When you have compassion for it, you're willing to see it more, right? But when you only have judgment and everything about it, you're not willing to see it at all. So the beauty of compassion and understanding of your facade and others is that you have more tolerance of what's going on. And I don't say that you tolerate it in the sense of you put up with it constantly, but you have more tolerance in the sense of tolerance to the feelings associated with it and tolerance to the fact that you have it rather than trying to remain in denial of it. Yeah. So, yeah, compassion, very important quality to develop, Pamela.
Yes, I need that. Because also when I started to have compassion for my own self, I really felt compassion for other people.
Correct.
Instead of judgment, and that was pretty good for me.
Yeah, correct. And in fact, I felt that emotion for many of you in yesterday's presentation, actually. And yesterday you were pretty open, which was very good. Yeah, because of that, you started to have some compassion for yourselves. Started, and this is a very important part of accepting your facade, having compassion for how it got created, having compassion for that little child who went through this terrible trauma and obviously was forced into creating it, and now even having compassion for the fact that you still do it, like you're still developing facade after facade depending on the interactions, because it's a learned behavior and it's something that we need to undo, but it is a learned behavior that we've spent all of our life learning. You know, you begun your education on your facade way before you begun your education going to school, right? So of course it's going to be quite, you're going to be quite good at it, right? All of us are experts, actually. We're experts. Reminds me, rule has been drips under pressure. Because that's really what we are. We are under pressure all the time from the environment to conform to it. And so what do? We just conform to the pressure, conform to the pressure, conform to the pressure. Yeah. It's going to require another quality. Can you see what the other quality is going to be? Courage. Yeah, courage. Courage, very important quality on earth. Once you get to the celestial heavens, you don't sort of need it very much, but because everyone around you is nice too. So of course you don't need it so much, but you've already developed it by that stage, right? But courage is a very important quality to develop because it means you're going to take action under the most adverse of circumstances. Right, and this is where many of you know that this is where you fail, right? You have a good idea when you're sitting at home by yourself, and then you go out into the world, and before you know it, what's happening? Oh, there I went again, and there I did it again, and there I did it again, and right, and the courage isn't there. Now, one thing I feel, courage is interesting for me because I feel there's sort of two loves that sort of create courage. And to me, courage in itself is not a sort of an emotion that I feel I have at all. The emotions that I feel I have is a deep love of the truth and a deep faith in God's goodness. And those two things create the what I would classify as the almost an illusion of courage. Do you see what I'm saying? In other words, I feel courage, and I'm not saying courage is an illusion, but it's probably the wrong choice of words, but I feel courage is an emotion that you need, but actually for me, courage comes from a deep love of the truth and a deep faith in God's goodness. In fact, I don't have, if you asked me to stand without God's goodness and without that love of truth, then I probably wouldn't or couldn't. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So for me, the love of truth and the love of God and God's goodness and my faith in that is what means that no matter what happens now, I will use my will in harmony with love and truth, and it doesn't matter what you do. I'm just going to do it. Does that make sense? Now, it looks like courage perhaps on the outside, but internally that's not how I feel it. I still feel afraid at times. Until you're at one with God, you're going to feel afraid at times. It's a scary world we live in sometimes, right? And until you're one with God, you will feel different fears. But if you have this deep love of the truth and a deep faith in God's goodness, that will carry you through every single potential event. Hmm. Okay, so we've covered some of that. Now, obviously, you know, there's things that we need to do without as well, isn't it? We need to deconstruct. These are things we need to construct. And part of the attitude, which we haven't got time to go through, is a whole series of things that we also need to deconstruct. You know, we need to deconstruct excuses, and we need to deconstruct different things like that. We need to make sure that we don't feed our addictions all the time, because feeding our addictions is really bad for you. It just reinforces your facade. You've got to be careful about reverting to anger and rage in order to manipulate and control other people, because that all that does is basically damage other people further, cause more pain to your own soul, actually. It actually increases the pain levels here as well, because there's a law of compensation in operation, as we'll learn in our next group. And so you know, every time you act out of harmony with love, your pain actually increases, which is actually not very clever when you think about it. It's not, is it? Like, doing things that make our pain later increase is a bit silly to do if you understood things. So you can see that there's a whole heap of things we're going to have to avoid as well. And in your outline, you have a list of some of those things that we have to avoid. In your outline, we also have mentioned the need for development of those tools. And it's not so much the development of the tools at this stage, it's the aspiration to develop the tool. Do you see the difference between developing the tool and developing an aspiration to develop the tool? Well, one is just developing the tool because you've been told you had to, and the other is developing the tool because you really want to. It comes from your heart, that you really want to do this, as a desire that comes from within yourself. And to me, that is going to be critical here, because you are the person with you 100% of the time. You're 24/7 living with you. Are you not? As soon as you go to sleep, you're 24/7. You know, you're still with you all the time. So you have the power, and you are really the only person who has the power to fully engage the deconstruction of your facade. Nobody else really can do it for you. All of God's laws have been created in order to help you do it. So all of God's laws are redemptive. They're trying to assist you through the deconstruction of this cycle of sin, right? But you have your will, which God holds as the most important gift that he's given you besides his love, right? And even the reception of his love is dependent upon the use of your will. So this tells us that basically one of the thing we need to do is make sure that we engage our will to develop an aspiration inside of ourselves, so that we are not reliant on anyone else to deconstruct our facade. God's laws will expose it. We need to address it. We're the ones who can do that. Nobody else can do that for us. And that gets back down to being self-responsible beings, doesn't it? You see, in this facade, we're not self-responsible beings. We're basically saying, gimme, 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 gimme all the things I want, right? And in order to get those things I want, I'm going to give you the things you want. And so you become dependent on me and I become dependent on you in that process. That's not self-responsible, is it? To become a self-responsible being, there's no gimme, gimme, gimme all the time. It's just you feeling every single emotion, you feeling all pain, all of your own terror. You're choosing to do that, and you're not expecting anybody else to assist you in any way, because you know God's laws are already being constructed to assist you to do it, and all it needs from you is your personal aspiration to do it. Just like anything that you choose to do in your life only needs your personal aspiration to do it, doesn't it? Like, you want to build a house, what do? You take the steps. You start the creation process. Nobody else does it for you, although people might be involved in the building of it for you. At the end of the day, you're the one who had to say you wanted it, and you're the one that had to engage your will to get all the money together and all the other things needed to build it. And so you are the person who created that. Without your will, that would not have been created. And the same applies to the facade. Without your will, it would not have been created, and only your will can destroy it. Nobody else can do that for you. God's not going to do it for you. God will help you, but God won't do it for you. You can't sit down watching telly and say, God, fix my facade. And the next day you come out, you go, oh, my facade's all gone now. Isn't it wonderful? We've got to stop this magical thinking, you know, that most of us have. Can you see that? God can't even perform a miracle on you while you remain in your facade. That's why God doesn't perform miracles on most of the people on the planet. Because God can't. You're using your will to oppose the process of a miracle being performed. So God can't even do that. Interesting, huh? Which is why miracles are pretty rare. Sess, just one more question and we'll... Oh, sorry, Glenda, we were at, weren't we? You've already submitted? I can't remember. No. You haven't?
I was going to
say... You were going to say.
Yeah, I was going to say we needed to give up the lies and the excuses and the justification and...
We do. Yeah, all those tools that we use to maintain our facade, they're all going to have to go, aren't they? And that's the a lot of this is the positive side, you know, what's going to have to go, but then there's a whole... All the negative stuff we do is going to have to go too. And can you see it's going to require quite a lot of attitude and work and some really sincere desire, aspiration on our part. It's going to require it, isn't it? And this is where most of us are failing. We don't have that strong desire to do it, right? And then we go, oh, but I don't get this divine truth. Oh, there's something wrong with AJ. What's wrong with these teachings? Like, you know, and we blame the teacher, we blame the teachings, we blame God, we blame everybody else other than the fact that we're using our will to maintain these blockages to receiving communication from God. Because really this is what it's all about. This part of ourselves is all about avoiding these two things, and God wants us to feel these two things because that's how God is going to have more open communication with you, by you allowing all your feelings. And if you're trying to select your feelings, God's going to have not much chance sharing his feelings with you. And if God can't share his feelings with you, God can't educate you. If God can't educate you, what's going to end up happening? Exactly the same as what's already happened. So it's something we need to address, yeah. Sis.
Jesus, given that... Given that we can be healed through God's love, why then did you, in the first century, and as you've said, you might again, you and Mary, and anyone who's at one with God might also perform miracles in
not
the future.
Not will.
Oh, will. Mm. Why do you perform miracles, and why does God allow miracles? Well, and how is it different?
Can you see the laws that I'm teaching you about all have to be engaged in order for a miracle to occur? This is why a miracle couldn't be performed on every person, because the laws weren't engaged. So, you know, what we call miracles on earth, God knows is just the engagement of certain laws that we ignore on earth.
I was just going to say, I mean, I feel like I've experienced, when God's laws are proven to me, I feel, wow, miracles, you know, small miracles, nothing I would necessarily be telling everyone about. But to me, it feels like just...
Yeah, but I'm talking now about physical miracles where, you know, where a person's completely healed from an illness, for example, from a disease. All of these kind of healings can only occur if God's laws are engaged. And for God's laws to be engaged, we have to engage it from our soul. And our soul doesn't include, like when I say our soul, I'm talking about the real self. It's got to be engaged from our real desires and passions. And the facade is just a great big lie about. And if we're trying to engage it all from our facade, it's never going to happen. That's why it doesn't happen for the majority of people. Any person who engages from their real self God's laws will have a miracle performed. Automatically. It's not like God's not going up there, oh, shall I do it this time or not?
Now you've mentioned from the real self, I've made a bit more connection.
Yeah. We talk about the real self in our third session, and I think you'll enjoy the conversation about our real self because it's quite a lot of detail to take in, but you know, that part of yourself is the part that you really want connecting with God. And that's why it's so important, because this pain was created by myself, society and others. This facade was created by myself, society and others. These things are not a part of my real self, are they? They're not a part of my real self. So, and who constructed them? Well, not God. God didn't construct them. So I'm going to have to, they're in me now. No one else can do anything about them now that they're in me. Only I can. So they're in me now, and only I can deconstruct them. God will help me, but he's not going to do it for me. Right? God will help me deconstruct my facade. God's laws are already governing the universe to help me deconstruct my facade. God made your soul to feel pain as well as pleasure. So God's already done all God needs to do to make sure that you can deconstruct all of these particular things. But at the end of the day, it does get down to, are you going to do it? Because if you're not going to do it, then you're not going to receive very much of God's love. The only time you're going to receive God's love is in the moments of clarity that you occasionally have, and for most of us it's like once a year or once every 6 months, we occasionally might have a moment of clarity where we're our real self. And in that moment, if you decided to have a desire, a prayer to God for God's love, then you'll receive some. That's the only time we're going to. Aside from that, unless we deconstruct this, we're never going to receive God's love all the time. That's why it's so important. I must finish, guys. I'm 20 minutes over. So what we'll do is we'll have a break until 12:30, and then we will have to have a shortened Q&A on this particular subject, on accepting my facade.